Brother Matt used to come and preach for me every now and then, and I told him he had more horse sense than a herd of wild Mustangs, and he could make a man feel lower than anybody I ever saw. But he's bringing, at the end of his message, he's always put God and man back together. He showed that there was an avenue of grace and love there that only God could show man. That we could show each other that kind of love. All right, the 16th chapter of the book of Ezekiel. The whole chapter is talking about unfaithful Israel and God's grace to them. God's offer of grace to them all the time. The word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, make known to Jerusalem her abominations. Make known to Jerusalem her abominations. What is an abomination?
Disgusting.
Something disgusting. Something that's disgusting. Make known to Israel her abominations. In families, there's been a lot of disappointments, haven't there? In life, there have been a lot of disappointments in families. You have a husband run off and leave his wife and leave his children. You have a wife run off and leave her children. And that's bad. Now, it says that Jesus suffered in all ways like we have. Didn't it? In all ways like we have. Now the difference in our God, as we look at him and all the cults and isms and everything else, how does Islam look at God? Let's think about Islam for a minute. How does Islam look at God?
I don't know.
He's high, he's holy, and untouchable. Now look at the Jehovah's Witnesses for a minute. Now how do they look at God? He's high, he's holy, and basically untouchable. Isn't it right? How about the Catholic Church? How do they look at God? He's high and holy and untouchable. The only way you can get to God in Catholicism is through who? Mary, his mother. All right, think about these for a while. How about the Mormon God? They just totally thrash God, don't they? They make him a god that reproduced other gods continually. And they were all gods in embryo. If we'll come to the knowledge of the Book of Mormon and the Pearl of the Great, you know, Doctrines, Covenants, and the Pearl of the Great Price and all this kind of stuff, we can be gods like him. And the only reason why he's higher than we are is because it takes us a while to catch up where he was 1,000 years ago, or 2,000 or 10,000 years ago. We're all progressing. Now that's total perversion of God, isn't it? But what about the other? What about the Bible's? How about the Bible's description of God? He's high, he's holy, isn't he? But he's not untouchable. That's the difference. He is touchable. He is touchable. He is tangible. The Bible says that God so loved man that he gave his only begotten Son. Now is God's Son God? Yes, he is. He's God's Son. What does God produce? The only Son he ever produced was Jesus. He brought himself into space and time in the person of Jesus Christ. All right? Why? So that he could be touched with our sins. Boy, was he touched with our sins? Was our sins put upon him? Sure was. Right on the cross of Calvary. In his life, did he experience rejection? How many of you have ever been rejected by your mother or father? You know, that hurts, doesn't it? Now, if I've heard people that, men and women both, that don't want to be in any relationship of the opposite sex. because they don't want to be hurt. Maybe they got hurt a little bit, or maybe they saw what their mother and father did with their lives, and they don't want any of it. But you know what else? They will never experience love. When you do that, you never experience love. And to experience love, you have to be touchable. You have to make yourself vulnerable. So God made himself vulnerable to redeem mankind back to himself. And he didn't send somebody else to do it. He did it. God came to redeem mankind back to him. The whole book of Ruth is about the kinsman redeemer. All of the Bible is talking about God becoming flesh. The name Jehovah itself means what? He who shall become. That's what his name means. What is the fulfillment of that? John 1:14. Kaihologos sarx eganeko, and the word, the Jehovah flesh, he became and dwelt among us. To redeem us back. And it says that he felt everything we feel. Name me when Jesus was rejected by one of his most boisterous disciples.
Peter.
When he denied him?
3 times! And then at the Sea of Galilee, after the resurrection and everything else, he goes out there, and we looked at this in the Greek class the other day. It's talked about when Jesus asked him, Peter, do you love me? He asked him, Peter, do you agapeo me? Agapeo means sacrificial love. Will you give your life for me? And then what did Peter say? Does anybody remember when I taught this from Greek before? What did Peter say? I like you. He didn't say he loved him. He said, I like you a lot. Philo. And then Jesus asked him the second time, he said, Peter, do you agapeo? Do you love me? Will you give your life for me? And Peter answered him again. Now, this is after he had denied him, remember. I think Peter was a little bit shy of saying that I'll give my life for him. Again, because he said before he would and he didn't. So he was a little bit cautious about saying that he loved him enough to give his life for him. And then he told the Lord again, he said, Jesus, you know that I fillet you. I like you a lot. And then the last time that Jesus asked him if he loved him, he didn't ask him if he loved him. He said, Peter, do you even like me? And he says, Lord, you know all things. He knew what that he had been rejected. Did Jesus feel that rejection? How about, you know, when he made his triumphant entry into Jerusalem, what happened? They just fell over backwards. They threw their clothes down on the ground. They said hallelujah and they praised Jehovah. And the Pharisees came to him and says, tell your disciples not to do this. They're saying that you're Jehovah God. They're praising you as Jehovah. And he said, if they wouldn't cry out what? The stones would cry out. And that those same people the next day, just days later, would demand his crucifixion. How do you think Jesus felt there? Do you think God is acquainted with your griefs? Have you had a spouse that betrayed you?
Oh, yeah.
Boy, you're in a lot of trouble, I think, brother. Bill's not here today. You have a spouse that betrays you, and it just beats your heart up. How about a child that breaks your heart? Have you ever had a child break your heart? There's an old saying, when they're little bitty children, they walk on your feet. When they grow up, they walk on your heart. Tread on your heart. That's the way to deal with people. Because you're vulnerable. God made himself vulnerable. Now look at God. Now, in this age that we live in, I said all of this, in this age that we live in, what age do we live in?
The church age.
That's this age right here. Now let's jump back for just a little bit earlier. Back into the age of the law, what we call the Mosaic Age, when Moses gave the law to Israel, and Israel was God's administrator in his kingdom. God's administrator in his kingdom now. Okay? Think about that. Now let's look at his wife. Israel was God's bride. In this age, we are part of the bride, if we are faithful. Righteous is what we call a conditional covenant. Did you know that? Being in the family of God, being saved, is not conditional. That's an unconditional covenant. But being the bride is a conditional covenant. Now, when you're in the bride, you have a lot in eternity, forever, you're going to have a lot of glory, benefits that others don't have. The saints during the tribulation period, you know what they're going to be in for eternity? They get saved in the tribulation period. People get saved by the thousands, by the millions in the tribulation period. Do you know that? But what are they going to be? What are they going to be for all eternity? Servants. They get to be with God, but they're going to be serving God. The bride is going to do what? It's going to sit on the throne with God, and they're going to judge. They're going to judge angels. The bride is. The bride is going to be his co-ruler with him.
You're saying the people that go up first are going to be up right on the throne, and the others that are saved during the rapture,
after the tribulation period, they're going to be servants. They're going to have a lesser place with the Lord than what they have an opportunity now. They have an opportunity to be saved during the tribulation period, but they'll never have the opportunity to be in such a close relationship with the Lord. And this in the church age, we have an ability to be very close to God, not just like all the saved. There's a lot of saved people out there in other churches. Okay, there are. But they don't have bridal relationship in some churches. It's just barely being saved. You're just saved yet so as by fire, so to speak. Okay, Sister Andino, you know what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. Saved you so as by fire. Now, the Lord's churches are his bride. And then in the book of Revelation, we see there, in the last part of the church age, he says that I am sick of you, his bride. He said, you make me sick. Okay? Now, in Ezekiel, the 16th chapter, we're going back into the administration of Israel as God's bride and his administrator in his kingdom. Now, let's see what she did to him. Okay? We got a lot of foundation here for the last 20 minutes to get you to where you can understand what's going on. Brett, you missed it.
Sorry, guys. I was late. The wind threw me off.
The wind blew you away.
Yeah.
All right. You ought to be out there where I am. We got a brand new foot of sand.
Dirt, I bet, yeah.
A brand new foot of sand.
We'll be out there shutting.
Then the word of the Lord came to me saying, Son of man, make known to Jerusalem her abominations. What does the word abomination mean? Her iniquities, her unspeakable sins. But God starts naming them. The unspeakable sins that she committed, he starts naming them. Thus says the Lord God, Jehovah Elohim, to Jerusalem, your origin and your birth are from the land of the Canaanite, and your father was an Amorite, and your mother a Hittite. As for your birth, on the day that you were born, your navel cord was not cut. You weren't even washed. You were unwashed, you were unclean. And guess what? Even though these people are your relatives, I chose you as a dirty little kid to be my bride. A dirty little kid. Unkept. And abandoned. In verse 7, I made you numerous like plants of the field. Then you grew up and became tall and reached the age for fine adornments. He said, your breasts were formed, your hair had grown, and yet you were naked and bare. And he said, I took care of you. He said, I passed by you and saw you, and behold, you were at the time for love. So I spread my skirt over you. Now that's what happened. Remember when Boaz and Ruth? remember when she went to the threshing floor and she asked him to put her, his skirt over her? What was the skirt a sign of?
The women's room.
On the skirt, on the man's skirt, on his long dress. He wore dress. They wore dresses, by the way, back then. On a man's skirt was the lineage and who he was. What estate he was, what family he was from, and that was, when he put his skirt over her, it meant that she would become his wife, and he would, and she would be in his lineage and in his protection from there on. And he said, I put my skirt over you. You became my wife. All right? You became my wife. I swore to you and entered you into a covenant with you so that you became mine, declares the Lord God. All right? You were the object of my love, he says. You were the object of my love. This woman. He said, I clothed you, in verse 10, and embroidered with embroidery cloth and sandals of porpoise skin on your feet, and I wrapped you with fine linen and covered you with silk. Did God take care of Israel? Did God take care of Israel? Always. He said, I'm going to take you into the land what? Flowing with what? Milk and honey. Milk and honey. By the way, milk and honey, those were the high, you're living high on the hog when you had milk and honey. Okay? That's real high living. That's champagne and caviar, you know. This is big, high living now, okay? High living. Milk and honey was high living. Honey was expensive. Salt was expensive, by the way. It says she wasn't even rubbed with salt before. Salt is a what? A disinfectant. You weren't rubbed with salt. Salt, you know, the wars have been fought over salt. Yeah? That's right. And onions, Marilyn will say.
I can't imagine rubbing a newborn baby with salt.
It was a disinfectant. They would take salt water and wash the child with salt water to kill. It was a disinfectant. That's how they disinfected. Actually, in many years in Italy, when a child was born, they would wash the child with wine, which was a disinfectant. My step-grandfather told me when he had drunk wine since he was a baby. He said, I was washed with wine, and they gave me a sip of wine when I was a baby. Like that. They washed him. They disinfected him. And back over in those countries, you know, they have dysentery. They have to drink wine daily. All of their water has wine in it to kill the bacteria. The wine bottles that Jesus spoke of in his time, it said, and the bottles of wine. All water that they drank then, if they carried a water bottle around, it had about 20% wine in it to kill the bacteria. In verse 11, and I adorned you with ornaments, and I put bracelets on your hands and a necklace around your neck, and I put a ring in your nose. That meant she was his bride. Now we put a ring on her finger, you know, but put it in her nose. All right? And earrings in your ears and a beautiful crown on your head. She was his princess. He loved her. And you were adorned with gold and silver, and your dress was fine linen and silk. You know, they didn't have, linen was only for the rich people. They had coarse goat's hair garments. They had wool garments. But he said, you were dressed with linen and silk and embroidered cloth. You ate fine flour. Only the rich could have flour made from wheat. Everybody else had oatmeal and barley. And by the way, they had low-grade barley and old-grade. How do you tell, like when they dig up a mummy in Egypt and everything else, how do you tell what class of person they were? What do they look at?
Their teeth.
What?
Their teeth.
Their teeth.
Yeah, that's right.
If they had poor food, their teeth were wore out. And if they had fine flour and the fine breads and everything else, their teeth were not worn out. It said, you ate fine flour and oil, and you were exceedingly beautiful and advanced in what? What do your different translations say? Advanced in what? Royalty. All right. Number 15. What is beauty? always tell people that most people are good looking at one time in their life. Girls are pretty and boys are good looking, so you can catch somebody. You can catch somebody, but it's fleeting, people. That's all I'm saying. Is it fleeting, Brother Rex?
You think that?
Yeah. My hair on my head, the radiation helped it go away. But I know it's still there because it started coming out my nose and my ears and all of them. It just moved.
Yeah.
My chest used to be over 50 inches, you know, now it's sagged and it's gone. This gravity took over. I guess that's what happened with the hair business. But you trusted in your beauty. If I'm beautiful to him, I'll be beautiful to somebody else. Okay? And played the what? The harlot, because of your fame. And you poured out your harlotries on every passerby who might be willing to lay with you. That's what he's saying. Now he's talking about his, God's talking about his broken heart. God is talking about his broken heart. Okay? God is talking about his broken heart. Can you break God's heart today? Like our children. When they're little, they walk on our feet. When they get older and they get grown, they walk on our hearts. Can your children break your heart? Can your mates break your heart? This is God's talking about his broken heart here. God's broken heart. And you looked, and you took some of your clothes and made for yourself high places of various colors and played the harlot on them, which you should never come about nor happen. You also took your beautiful jewels made of gold and silver, and I had given you and made for yourself what?
Images.
Male images. That you could play the harlot with them. Then you took your embroidery cloth and covered them and offered the idols. And offered oil and the oil and incense that I gave you, you offered to false gods. You played, that's what we call spiritual fornication, people. God's broken heart. Also my bread, which I gave you, and fine flour and oil and honey with which I fed you, you offered before them for a soothing aroma, and it happened, declares the Lord God. I guarantee you it happened. You betrayed me. God's talking about his broken heart. And moreover, you took your sons and your daughters you had born to me. Your sons and your daughters you had born to me, and sacrificed them to idols to be devoured. And then it says down here, and we talked about this a little bit last week. You slaughtered my children. My children. You slaughtered my children. The children you had with me. You despised the children that you bore to me. You despised them. And you made them pass through the fire. And remember what I said last week about this little episode here? They were firewalkers. Remember, you know, they had on Ripley's Believe It or Not and everything. They had people that would walk on fire. They'd go into a trance. They'd start walking on fire. They were delving in witchcraft. You made witches. You made mediums out of my children. My children, he said. Beside all these abominations, hardly these, you did not remember the days of you when you were naked and bare and squirming in your blood. And then verse 23. Remember in the New Testament, the book of Matthew, he said, woe unto you, Pharisees, scribes, and hypocrites. Remember that when he said woe? What does he say in 23? Then it came about after all your weakness, woe, woe to you, declares the Lord, that you built yourself a shrine and made yourself high places on every square. You built for yourself high place on every street. And you made your beauty abominable, and you spread your legs to everybody that would pass by that would multiply your harlotries with. This is God's broken heart. He's telling this straight out. You played the harlot with the Egyptians. Egypt is a type of what in the Bible?
The world.
You played harlot with the world. Can God's churches play harlot with the world today?
Oh, yeah.
They are. Your lustful neighbors and multiplied your harlot to make them angry. Behold, now I have stretched out my hand against you and diminished your rations. I cut back on your food supply, Israel. You're not quite going to have the food you had before. And he said, and I delivered you up to the desire of those who hate you, the daughters of the Philistines. They're ashamed of your lewd, even the world is ashamed of your lewd conduct. And you're supposed to be my wife? And even the heathens are ashamed of what you're doing? You played the harlot with the Assyrians because you were not satisfied. You even played the harlot with them and still were not satisfied. Verse 29, and you multiplied your harlot tree in the land of Chaldee. That's the Babylonians, remember. This is God talking about his broken heart. How languishing is your heart, declares the Lord God, while you do all these things, the actions of the bold-faced harlot. What, you ever heard of a bold-faced liar? This is a bold-faced harlot. She did have no shame. That's what you call sociopathic. You know what sociopathic means? No conscience. Just go right on, just do, steal, whatever. You built your shrine at the beginning of every street and made your high place in every square, sustaining money. You were not like a harlot. Verse number 32 is a very unusual thing. You adulterous wife who takes strangers instead of her husband. You will push your husband away and welcome the strangers. This is God's broken heart he's talking about. Men give gifts to harlots. They pay for their services. But you give gifts to your lovers. You pay your lovers. The average woman, the average harlot, gets paid for her harlotry. But you're paying men to come to you. Boy. You bribe all your lovers from every direction for your harlotries. Thus you are different from those women in the harlotries, in that one plays a harlot, as you do, because you give money, and no money is given to you. Thus you are different than all of the other harlots. Therefore, O harlot, hear the word of the Lord. Boy, I told you now, Brother Madden is coming on the scene in this one. If you'd ever heard him preach. He's stomping on Israel with both feet. He's trying to get them to repent, people. That's what he's trying to do. And this ought to make us repent today, too. It ought to change our thinking. There's a difference between true child of God and somebody that make-believe, a make-believer. A true child of God repents of their sins and calls upon God, and their lives are changed. A person that just goes to church for social... for social reasons, you know, that's the thing to do. It's nice to do with church and things, you know, this is what we do. But when you really believe in your heart, things change in your life. Because of your lewdness, in verse number 36, poured out on your nakedness and uncovered through your harlotries with your lovers and with all the detestable idols, because of the blood of your sons which you gave to idols. Therefore, behold, I will gather all your lovers whom you took pleasure in, even those whom you loved and all those whom you hated. So I shall gather them against you from every direction and expose your nakedness to them. He said, I'm going to pull your skirt over your head. That's what he said. That in the original, that's why I'm going to pull your skirt over your head. I'm going to show your lewdness to the world. They may see your nakedness. Number 38. Thus I shall judge you like women who commit adultery, or shed blood, or judge. And I shall bring on you the blood and wrath of what?
Jealousy.
Is God jealous? Is God jealous of you? God is jealous of you. It's a righteous jealousy. Now, are husbands jealous of their wives? They love their wives. And there's a certain amount of righteous jealousy you have. You don't want somebody else running off with your wife, do you? You like your wife a lot, Fernando? You don't want anybody running off with her, do you? No. All right. Rex, you kind of got used to her cooking and stuff. You don't want you don't want anybody to run off.
Sometimes.
Wrath and jealousy. All right. I shall also give you into the hands of your lovers. Now what God is going to say here, he said, I'm going to have them come into your land, and all of this land that I have given you, the land flowing with milk and honey, and I'm going to have your lovers tear your place up. You're going to tear your house down. They're going to tear down all of your idols and all of your little places where you played the harlot with others, all the spiritual fornication you did. They're going to tear all of your high places down. Why would they tear the high places down? Why would the Babylonians come in and tear down Israel's idols and their shrines? What would they want there?
The gold.
What?
The gold.
The gold and the silver. And the fine silks and linen and the carved statues. They're going to take them home. That was what we call the spoils of war. I shall give you in the hands of your lovers, and strip you of your clothing, take away your jewels, and will leave you naked and bare. They didn't have anything to eat. You know, when Israel was carried off at different times, when they were carried off in the captivity, they sold Jews for slaves. They did. Marilyn was watching the program the other day. What was it about that? When they bought these people as slaves, they didn't feed them. They were so cheap. They bought them and they worked them until they were dead and starved to death.
In South America.
Yeah, South America. They bought the Jews and they fed them so little they didn't care whether they died or not. They just buy another one. Work them until they fell over dead from starvation. Strip you of your clothing. Take away your jewels and leave you naked and bare and starving. They will incite a crowd against you, and they will stone you and cut you to pieces with swords. And did they do that? They will burn your house with fire and execute judgments on you in the sight of many women. And I shall stop you from playing the harlot. And you will no longer pay your lovers. You won't have any money to pay them with. And I shall calm my fury against you, and my jealousy will depart from you, and I shall be pacified and angry no more. And he said, you have an older sister in number 46. But let's go back up to verse 44. There's a little thing in there that's pretty good. Behold, everyone who quotes Proverbs will quote this proverb concerning you, like mother, like daughter. All right. You've heard that term, haven't you? Like mother, like daughter, like son, like father. Like father, like son. You who are the daughter of your mother, who loathed her husband and children. The mama hated her husband and her children. You also are a sister of your sisters, who loathe their husbands and children. Your mother was a Hittite and your father an Amorite. Your older sister is what? Samaria. Who lives north of you with her daughters, and your younger sister who lives south of you is Sodom and her daughters. Yet you have not merely walked in their ways or done according to their abomination, but as if they were too little, you acted more corruptly in all of your conduct than they did. Now they were lesser in my esteem, but they were better than you were. As I live, declares the Lord God, Sodom your sister and her daughters have not done as you and your daughters have done. Number 49, behold, this was the guilt of your sister Sodom. She and her daughters had arrogance and abundant food and careless ease, but she did not help the poor and needy. Thus they were haughty and committed abominations before me, and therefore I removed them when I saw it. Furthermore, Samaria did not commit half your sins, for you have multiplied your abominations more than they. Thus you have made your sisters appear righteous by all of your horrible deeds. Now, think about it when Jesus walked into the land of Galilee and the land of Israel. The Jews wouldn't even walk through Samaria, would they? They'd go a long way around. They wouldn't take a shortcut through Samaria. Where did Jesus go?
the well, the Good Samaritan?
That's right. John the 4th chapter, we know that. He went to the well there in Samaria. And that Samaritan woman came out there. Now that woman was a loose woman. Think about that now. That woman described Israel in the 16th chapter of Ezekiel. That woman in the 4th chapter of John. Let's go there. John the 4th chapter. Look at it real quick. John chapter 4. Talks about Jesus making and baptizing more disciples than John. Yeah, although Jesus himself was not baptizing. But what you can put in there is his church was. Because his church was already in existence. The church was baptizing and making disciples. And so he came to the city of Mary, called Sychar, near a parcel of ground that gave to his son Joseph. And Jacob's well is there. By the way, I've been there. I drank water out of Jacob's well. I did. And he gave to his son Joseph. And his journey was sitting thus by the well, and it was about 12 o'clock noon. It's hot 12 o'clock noon. He was thirsty. And there came a woman of Samaria to draw water, and Jesus said to her, give a drink of water to me. Please give me a drink of water. Now let's see what this woman says to him. For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy some food. And the Samaritan woman looked at him and said, how is it that you, being a Jew, asked me for a drink of water since I am a Samaritan woman? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. That's in parenthesis, by the way. Jews wouldn't have anything to do with these half-breeds. Brother Rex, you ever been called a half-breed? Indian?
I'm not sure about that.
I have. I had people call me a half-breed before. Well, I'm 86.6% Indian, but I'm a half-breed. There's one group of Indians up here by Isabella that unless you're a 100% their tribe, you can't be a member of their tribe. That's what you call bigotry. Proudness. The rest of them are half-breeds. So these Jews looked upon these people as half-breeds. Half Assyrian, half Jew. They wouldn't have anything to do with them. And not only that, but here's a woman. This woman is a low-down harlot. She's a loose woman. She is an unfaithful woman. In Israel, a woman like this would have been killed. She'd have been stolen. If she'd have been married to some Pharisee, she'd have been short-lived. That's all I can say. And Jesus answered and said, if you were knew the gift of the God and who it is that talks to you, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. That means running water. This well was not living water. That's like a cistern, a well. Running water is a stream. Running water is a flowing well where water runs out of it and down. That's they were when they did sacrifices in the law, they had to use running water. It was what we call live water, living water. And he's saying, I'm going to have running water. I could give you running water. I could pipe water all the way to your house. Flowing water. Out there where I live, there was a well out there. We had a fig tree out in the backyard, but the winds blew so hard last year, it blew the fig tree plumb out of the ground. I'd say plumb out of the ground. Yeah, that's an Oklahoma term, plumb out. Okay? It blew it up, roots and all, out there. But for many, many years, Zorro, have you ever seen the movie Zorro? Zorro was, his real name was what? Joaquin Marietta. And there were five of them. Where I live out there was where Joaquin Marietta used to rest his horses. Out there, there was a creek or a stream in the backwater, a stream of living water. It was a spring. And the spring was good. And people all around there had rights to that spring later on. But in 1850 and through there, Joaquin Marietta would come there, and there was all kinds of pasture out there, and he'd water and rest his horses when he was taking the horses out of the San Joaquin Valley. Then he'd take them down to Cucamonga, down by San Bernardino, and rest them one more time, and then they'd drive them all the way to Sonora. Okay? Living water. That was the only place out there that had this good water. The rest of the whole valley, the San Joaquin Valley, was stagnant water. Where it would come down, it was bayous. and swamps. Coles Levee, you know where Coles Levee is out there by town? See, all those were levees out there. Roads on high ground between bodies of water, a swamp, a bayou. Okay. Now he said, I can give you living water. He said, are you not greater than our father Jacob? Are you who gave us the well and drank of it himself and his sons, and his cattle? Are you greater than Jacob that dug this well? And Jesus answered, said to her, everyone who drinks of this water shall what? Thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall become in him a well, a spring of water, springing up to eternal life.
A living water.
Living water. And the woman said to him, sir, what she actually said to him was Kyrios. And Kyrios means what? Adonai, Master Jehovah. She recognized who he was now. Sir, give this water so I will not be thirsty nor come here to draw anymore. By the way, every time that woman went to the well, everybody made fun of her because she was a loose woman. And where in the Bible, how many times did people meet a wife at the well?
Jacob
did. Huh?
I know Moses did.
Moses?
I thought Jacob did too.
Huh? Where did Isaac get his wife? Remember when Abraham sent his servant and he saw her at the well. And then Jacob at the well. All of these people at the well, at the well, at the well. That seemed like a place where people got engaged. Okay. Maybe this is where she met her lovers too. How many lovers did she walk off and leave? Lord, Master, give this water to me, that I will be thirsty no more and not have to come here to draw. And he said to her, go call your husband and come here. Now he's calling her to repentance. Now he's saying, you harlot. Now he said, I know your heart. God knows our hearts, doesn't he? And the woman said to him, I have no husband. And Jesus said to her, you have said, well, I have no husband. She didn't have a husband. She's living with somebody else's husband. She sold somebody else's husband. This woman did. Some women like to do that. Some women pride themselves in stealing husbands. Did you know what? Have you ever known anybody like that in your life? Come on now. You're a hairdresser, weren't you, Linda?
Yeah.
You knew people like this, didn't you?
Yeah.
Prided themselves in stealing up somebody else's husband. Number 18. For you have had five husbands, and the one whom you now have is not your husband, he's somebody else's husband. This you have said truly, and the woman said to him, Jehovah, I perceive that you are a prophet, Master Adonai. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain. Now she's going to ask him a very important religious question. She said, am I right? Now she asked him, am I doing the right thing? Am I worshiping the correct God? My ancestors worshipped in this mountain up here, Samaria. They had a hill up there. They had a mountain up there in Samaria. Mount Gerizim. That's where they worship. It's still there. They still have, they study it to these, the Samaritans today, they only recognize the five books of Moses. Did you know that? And they have some of the oldest copies of scriptures in the world. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, Mount Gerizim, and you people say in Jerusalem it's a place where men ought to worship. Remember when the north and the south, southern Israel and northern Israel split? This is where they call Judah and Israel. Now God looks upon them as one people. Verse 21, what's it say there? Are you over there, Connie? 21?
No, I'm not.
Oh, John, 421, are you over there, Rex?
Yeah.
Okay.
Jesus said to her, woman, believe me, an hour is coming when neither in this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father.
You worship that which you do not know. You worship that which you don't understand. We worship the Jews in Jerusalem. We worship that which we know. For salvation is what? Of the Jews. They are the administrator of God's kingdom, regardless. And they were debunked. But that is where the salvation was going to come from. But an hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and truth. For such people the Father seeks to be his worshipers. And then verse John 4:24 is a very, very important verse. Dr. John, what's it say there? John 4:24.
God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth.
All right. For God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. And then verse number 25, Sister Andino, are you over there?
Yes. The woman said to him, I know the Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things.
Jessica, sunshine, are you over there?
Yes, sir.
Verse number 26, I'm going to let you read the punchline.
Okay, then Jesus declared, I who speak to you am he.
I am. Ego Amy. What did he quote right there?
That he was the Messiah?
Who is he? Go so back to Exodus 3:14. She
Moses,
believes in the book of Exodus.
When he told Moses, I am who I am.
I am who I am. That's who the eternal God. He said, I am the eternal God. I am. Ego Amy. That's what he said. Exodus 3:14. Who's over in Exodus 3:14?
I am.
Oh, okay, Brother John, go ahead.
And God said to Moses, I am who I am.
That's right. What a jolt! This woman had, she started calling him Lord, Master. And now he tells her, I am the great I am of the Old Testament. I am the Creator. I am. Speak to you. I am He. And verse number 27. Let's see what happened here now. Now the disciples come up. And they are what we call smudged. You know what you call smudged? You ever get your face smudged a little bit with dirt? You get out there working on something, you get dirt in your face and get smudged up with dirt. They're a little bit contaminated with the ideas of the Jews. And at this point, his disciples came and they marveled. They were struck out of their senses. They were amazed that he had been speaking with a woman. Not only a woman, but this woman. This woman, a loose woman. Now, when the Jews, sit down here for a minute. When the Jews took their mamas to town, their wives, when the Jews took their wives to town to go shopping with them, let me tell you something. They were not allowed to talk to their wives in public. Did you know that? It was considered lewd conduct. Considered lewd conduct. Now here we have Jesus out in public speaking to a woman. Now, is there any place in the Old Testament law where it says that you're not supposed to talk to your wife or a woman in public? No. They made that law themselves. That was a law of their own invention. That was not a law of God. That was a law of their own invention. Can religions make more rules than God do? Can religions make more rules? I tell you what, false religion, boy, they can hook you up in harness. Do you know that? False religion can fix your wagon. They can hook you up in harness. But one thing about God is God does what? He turns you free. You're free. All right. disciples are, now they're disappointed in Jesus. He has broke the law. He should be stoned in public. He should be stoned. He has broke the laws of the Pharisees and the scribes. What do you seek, or why do you speak with her? What do you want from this woman? That's what they're asking. What do you want from this woman, Jesus? What's going on here? This is a loose woman. What do you want from her? What are you asking this woman about? So the woman left her water pot and went into the city and said to the men of the city, come and see a man who told me all the things that I have done. Is this not the Christ? Isn't this the Messiah? And they went out of the city. It says, and they kept on, in the original language, it says that they just kept on pouring out of Samaria to hear Jesus speak. They were coming to him, and in the meanwhile, the disciples were requesting, he says, Rabbi, eat. Now, he was starving when they left, and they didn't have any food, so they went into town. And then what did Jesus say to them in verse number 32? Linda, are you over there? John 4:32.
Meanwhile, the disciples were urging Jesus to eat. No, he said, I have some food you don't know about.
All right. The food of the Spirit. You know, Moses went up on that mountain for 40-something, I think 47 days at one time without eating or drinking. Do you think God provided? He had food to drink, which they know of. Jesus went out in the wilderness for what? 40 days and fasted. Did he have food? Not physical food, but he had food to sustain him. And the disciples, therefore, were saying to one another, no one brought him anything to eat, did they? And Jesus said to them, my food is to do the will of him that sent me and to accomplish his work. All right. What a story. But do you see how the book of Ezekiel just go? What happened in Ezekiel just goes right over into the New Testament? The Samaritans? Now, I want to ask you something. How many bad things did Jesus say about Samaritans? Didn't name it. Can you think of anything? The Samaritan woman. That's what he said about her. They believed. But in his own city of Nazareth, where he went, when he stood up and says, in this day, in your hearing, this folk scripture is fulfilled, what did they want to do to him? Stone him. They wanted to murder him. Let's go back now to Ezekiel, the 16th chapter. In verse number 53, he talks about up there in 51 and 52, he talks about Samaria. And he said, your sisters, Samaria, have been so much better than you that they look righteous. Nevertheless, I will restore their captivity, the captivity of Sodom, the daughters of the captivity of Samaria and her daughters, along with them, in your captivity. In order that you may bear your own humiliation and feel ashamed for all that you have done and become a consolation to them. And your sister Sodom and her daughters of Samaria with her daughters will return to their former state, and you with your daughters will return to your former state. God said, I'm going to call you back home. I'm going to give you another chance. I thank God that he gives us more chances than one, doesn't he? God give you an extra, did he give you a second chance? He never gave me a second chance. He had them. You know, we ought to. Yes. We ought to thank God for our salvation. Sometimes we can go the wrong way in our lives. When you've been saved, you can go the wrong way. You can't. You can go the wrong way. God can have to break your neck sometimes and get you back in line. And you know what? You wear that, those stripes, the rest of your life. In 17th chapter, we get over there and talk about the eagles, the king of Babylon and everything. In the 16th chapter, verses 62 and 63, I want you to remember this as we go in this 17th chapter. Thus I will establish my covenant with you, and you shall know that I am the Jehovah, I am the Lord. And in order that you may remember and be ashamed and never open your mouth anymore because of your humiliation, when I have given you for all that you have done, the Lord declares. Remember where you came from. When I tell my little girl when she's going to go out on her own, I said, remember who you are. Remember your PK. Preacher's kid. Remember that whenever you go out. Remember who you are. Then he talks about the Septuagint character, talks about the two big eagles. And he's going to bring Babylon against them, and he's going to bring Assyria against them. And even though Zedekiah had made a covenant with Egypt, he said, I'm going to whoop Egypt too. I'm going to whoop your boyfriend. I'm going to whip him. I'm going to run his, all the horses in the ground. Then we come over here to the 18th chapter. The 18th chapter of Ezekiel. Now, God deals personally with every one of you. You know that? Has any of you not had the Spirit of God work on your heart? Well, has he? God works on your heart with his Spirit. You can, once you've been saved, you're saved forever. There's an old saying that a man wrote down a long time ago. Is, you may sin securely, but safely never. You're never going to lose your salvation, but boy, you're not going to be safe either. We're all individuals. Israel as a nation was corrupt. In the last days, God's churches basically become corrupt. They become materialist. They become materialist churches with things. But there are some in the churches that are going to remain faithful. There were some people in Israel that were faithful. Can you name a couple of people when Jesus came on the scene? High officials in Jerusalem. Servants of God that were faithful. Can you name me a couple of them?
Nicodemus.
Who?
Nicodemus.
Nicodemus was, but he was still, I tell you what, he was. But when he came to Jesus in the third chapter, he wasn't a believer yet.
Joseph?
Joseph of Arimathea. Who else?
I can't remember the last one.
How about Anna? How about the old man that had been looking for the Messiah? He was looking for Jehovah to come along. Remember him? Mm-hmm. And then he said, when he saw him, he said, what? Let me die now. I have seen my Savior. Let me die now. I'm happy. I live a long life. We're all individuals. And let's look and see. That's why I wrote this word up here. What's that word? Anybody know? Nefesh. Starts out. Nefesh.
Soul.
That's it. Nefesh.
Means what?
Soul, I think.
I mean soul. Man is spirit, he's body, and he's soul. All right, let's look at this now. Nefesh. What part of a man is soul? Huh? That's his soul, is his consciousness. That's his mind. That's where he lives, in the deepest part of your being. That's where you are. Nobody ever knows you in this world like you know your own soul, do you? You live in your soul. You sleep and you dream in your soul. You think in your soul. You are your soul. Your body follows along, doesn't it? Your spirit follows along. Okay? When we're born into the world, we have the spirit of rebellion in us. Adam's spirit. When we're born again, that spirit is exed out and kicked out, and we have spirit God in us. Now, spirit God convicts us of sin, righteousness, and judgment to come before we're saved to salvation, and then after we're saved because of salvation. Okay? And we have a body, which just kind of wanders along with us. Doesn't it? You ever have any aches and pains, Brother Fernando? Every day. What aches you the most? Your feet, your shoulders, your back?
Everything,
all at the same time. Anna, you have anything that slows you down? Brother Rex, you don't have any aches and pains?
No, not one.
I tell you, how many of your spirit has ever suffered much? Your spirit suffers sometimes because of what your body does, doesn't it? How about your soul? Does it ever suffer? Now let's look at, we've got all this down here, nephesh, and this word is psyche here, psyche. This is where we get, it's like that, psyche, okay? It's got a P in there, just like this one over here, nephesh. Now, in Hebrew, if it's got a little dot right there, that means it's a strong P, like that. Otherwise, it's a PH, all right? In Greek, we have something like that. That's a phi, P-H-I, all right, like Phillips, my name, okay? And now we have psyche here. Psst, psst, psst. It starts with like a C, but like psychology. You just swallow that. So that's a soft one here, okay? Get a little Greek too. And a little Hebrew while you're at it. 18 and verse number 1, Brother Connie, are you there? 18 and 1, Ezekiel 18 and 1.
Let me find it here.
All right, Ezekiel 18 and 1.
The exile was not the result of the sins of a single generation, rather the continued disobedience of Israel through many generations since the
Okay,
day.
Is that 18 and 1? It said, then the word of the Lord came to me saying.
Oh, okay.
All right, there we go.
The word of the Lord came to me saying again.
All right, and then the word of the Lord. Okay, let's look at this. Here we have another little word. The bar. The word of the Lord came to me. That's the word, word. Can you say that? It's like the bar. That's it. The bar. It's backwards from our English, but the bar. Hadabar. Is what? The word. Okay? Ha the bar. Now, John 1:1, what does it say there?
John 1:1.
NRK. Ein hologos. That's what it says in Greek. In beginning. Capital being the word. The bar. The word. Now there's two ways to look at the word. As a written word. Written. And the physical word. What is the physical word of God? That's God in person. All right, let's look at it. And the word of the Lord came to me right here talking about the Dabar, but also it's also used for the name of God. What is the name of God?
Hashem.
Huh? Hashem, the name. What is his name?
Jehovah.
That's his name right there.
But the Jews, they refer to him as Hashem.
Huh? Hashem, they referred to him as the name. All right. Or Hardabar, the word. So when John wrote the word, what's he talking about?
Jehovah.
Jehovah. And the word, and who is the word? Jesus. All right. Now Jesus said, in my word, he said several times in his ministry, in my word, it says what? All right. And the word of the Lord came to me saying, Connie, verse number 2.
What do you mean when you use this proverb concerning the land of Israel, saying, the fathers have eaten sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge?
All right. Now, what it means here, are the children responsible for what the fathers did? We are all individuals. We're going to look at this more next week. We're all individuals. The soul, the psyche, that sins, it shall what? The soul that sins. Verse number 4. Behold, all our souls are mine. All souls, all nephishes are mine. All souls, all individuals are mine. The soul of the Father as well as the soul of the Son is mine. And what's the last part of that say? Verse number 4. Connie, are you still there?
Verse number 4?
Uh-huh.
Behold, all souls are mine. The soul of the Father as well as the soul of the Son is mine. The soul who sins shall die.
All right. The soul who sins. The individual who continues to live in sin, that just goes on practicing sin as his way of life, shall eternally die. He shall have eternal death. What is that? What is this eternal death? Right on the chart, the lake of fire. All right, thank you for your attention this week. Had a long lesson, but I hope it was productive. Did you learn something from the book of Ezekiel? Did he bless you today, old boy? Even though he was walking and squishing Israel like grapes? Calling her everything but the good? That's when God had the broken heart. The broken heart of God. All right. What?
We're here for now.
Brett, do you have an announcement?
I have an announcement.
You have an announcement? Do you have any prayer requests, or you want me to do that?
No, you can do that if you want.
Okay. You get up here and tell the announcements, and I'll do the prayer requests, okay?
We thought Dave would be here today. The beloved one's gone, huh?
Yeah, all the beloved ones are gone today. Well, we had one David.
Oh, I want to ask a question, too. So maybe everybody just wants to know this.
What?
When animals die, do they go to heaven or not, and why?
You know what? We don't have enough from the Bible to know.
Really?
But they are, the Bible calls them, it says that they have souls. That's all I can tell you.
Well, they need a spirit to go to heaven, though, right?
They have souls.
Because I always thought that they did, I thought for sure they did for a while, but then I thought they didn't.
A lot of people looked at animals and just...
Kibbe been talking about
it. Huh?
I mean, Kibbe says that they go to heaven, you know. And she was all bad when I
told her. There's a movie, all dogs.
They didn't. She's all, no, they do, come on, you know.
There's been a whole, there for many, many years, people just looked over the animal life. But people became so materialistic that they just looked upon animals as something to use and kill. But as we go in the Old Testament, in the days of Noah, all in the earlier days of Noah, if a man killed an animal, he was guilty of what? Capital punishment. If you killed an animal, you die. It was capital punishment. Not until after they got off the ark, mankind, all from before the flood all the way back there, man was vegetarians. If they killed an animal, it's just like killing a man. You were stoned to death. You killed an animal, you shed its blood, you died. Those pigs there at the Sea of Galilee, when the demons went into them, they chose to die rather than live like that man had in the tombs. So they had a choice. The snake in the garden, Nahash in the garden, had a choice. And when he had a choice and loaned his body to Satan, then even to the millennial kingdom, he will still be in a low estate. He will still be crawling on his belly instead of walking up on his legs. All I can tell you, there is some places in the Bible that tells that animals do have choice. And whether they go to heaven or not, I don't know, but maybe they do.
We don't know.
That's something we don't know about.
Cain and Abel.
Uh-huh.
Abel brought an offering of his sheep
flock
to the Lord.
Yeah.
Okay, what did they do with their sheep? Did they kill it?
They killed the sheep and they put it on the altar and God consumed it. They didn't eat that sheep.
So is this their sacrifice?
The only thing they kept off of that sheep was the clothing.
Where it says the lamb will lay down with the lion, uh-huh. And then you come back on horses, wouldn't that mean that there would be...
There's horses in heaven, there's animals in heaven, we know that. Yeah. We know that they're there. Whether they're animals that lived here and went on over there, we don't know for sure, but maybe. It's a possibility that they are.
Yeah.
I don't know. I can't tell you they are, but I can't tell you they are not. But there's hints that say maybe they are.
Guess we don't need to know.
We'll find out. We'll find out.
I hope my dog's up there. My dog died. It's almost sad, you know. Okay, so we got a men's power lunch coming up here. We got speaker Larry O'Pow. He's a superintendent of Fresno schools in 2006, and at 15 months of age, he was struck with polio, and he's an inspiration to everyone, he says. He was a champion wrestler and coach, an avid golfer, and a gymnast. In addition to this, he's a minister and singer and songwriter, and he has a wonderful testimony coming up Thursday, April 7th, 11:30 till 1 o'clock. And they have a when, who, what, where, why. Who is everybody who wants to come? Friends, dads, moms. They have a lunch buffet at Hodel's for like $13. And of course, it's at Hodel's, Newton Drive, near Olive, in 99. And we encourage fellowship and fun for all men and ages. Pardon women, too. I don't know why they always have to come to the men, but that's twice in a row they got that wrong.
Oh, wow. Thank you, brother.
All right, welcome.
Remember our prayer request. Please remember Gina Tanaka in Japan, our student over there. Her family and she are alive, but they are suffering with aftershocks and, of course, need of food. I wrote her a letter asking her if we could do anything for her. I don't know what we can do. I don't know whether money will do her any good. You know what? Money's not going to do you much good at all. Remember when I preached a sermon here a while back, no God,
silver,
no guns,
gold,
and no
guns.
Guns. That's just it. The way it, I mean, I'm going to tell you what, when it comes down to the nitty-gritty, gold's not going to do you any good. Remember over in the book of Revelation where I told them that you know, that they're not going to have any food? That the common working man is only going to get what he, from the very poorest barley, like those poor people in Egypt ate, barley and wheat. That's all. That's all. No Dr. Pepper. No soda. No champagne over there. That's only for the rich. That's only for the princes that are ruling in that period of time. All right. Remember, Gina and your family. Remember Troy and Cody and Jeanette and Dale and all them back in Alabama that are studying our classes back there and having church right there even today. John Capel in Australia and Kevin and Katie Perney in Idaho Falls, Idaho. Remember all these people, and then what other prayer requests do we have? Do you have any? Your mother, remember your mother, her mother in prayer, Rosalie, that is. And we had prayer for all of us. Remember each other in your prayer.
Your mom.
Remember my mother in your prayers. She's doing better. She was out at my house for lunch yesterday. And remember some unspoken prayer requests from that also, please. And Marilyn's looking for a job. She got okayed this last week as a caregiver for the county, and maybe she'll get a job. And Dakota's looking for a job also. Everybody's looking for a job but me, and I'm overemployed. Anyway, let's have a word of prayer. Does anybody want to lead us in prayer? Does anybody want to volunteer? Brett? You're volunteering?
I'm volunteering. I shrugged my shoulders.
He volunteered. All right. He shrugged his shoulders and volunteered. That's what you get for moving, boy.
All right. Dear Father in Heaven, thank you for everything in this great class and all the information you give us. And we're so thankful for your salvation and your mercy that you gave that to us so we can keep on keeping on in heaven. And please thank you, Lord. And we pray for this great church and everybody, the Marines, that tune into our class, and everybody, Lord, we just pray that they continue and they learn something from this class. We pray your name, amen.
Amen.
Amen.